Welcome once again, everyone, to another episode of Race to AIS Current Affairs Guru. Today, we are going to discuss some important current events that has happened between 15th and 30th of June. The first one is regarding India's first ever national forecast on the impact of global warming. It predicts annual rainfall to increase along with more severe cyclones, but at the same time, more droughts. These forecasts are based on a climate forecasting model developed at the Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology or IITM, Pune. Some more facts regarding the forecast is given in the slide. Next is regarding Khelo India State Centers of Excellence. They are established by Ministry of Youth and Sports. Under this, one center of excellence will be identified in each state and union territory, with an effort to create a robust sporting ecosystem in the entire country. In the first leg, the ministry has identified state-owned sports facilities in 8 states of India, which are Karnataka, Odisha, Kerala, Telangana, and other northeast states of Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur, Mizoram, and Nagaland, which will be upgraded into Khelo India State Centers of Excellence. In the next news item, we discuss the strategic importance of Galwan Valley, which has been all over the news in the recent times due to China's aggression. You can see the location of Galwan Valley in the map of the screen. The strategic significance of the area is due to its proximity to Daulatbagh Galdi or DBO. DBO is the northernmost corner of Indian territory in Ladakh, in the areas better known as known in army parlance as Subsector North. It has the world's highest airstrip, originally built during the 1962 war but abandoned until 2008 when the Indian Air Force revived it as one of its many advanced landing grounds or ALGs along the line of actual control or LIC. Thus, we can see how important this area is strategically and why China is trying to have control over it. The area gains further strategic importance because to the west of DBO is the region where China abuts Pakistan in the Gilgit-Baltistan area, once a part of the erstwhile Kashmir Principality. More details regarding the area is given in the slide. Those who want can pause the video and read. Next is regarding India's first mobile diagnostic unit for COVID testing called iLab or Infectious Disease Diagnostic Lab for COVID testing in rural and inaccessible areas of India. It was inaugurated and flagged off by the Minister of Science and Technology, Earth Sciences and Health and Family Welfare Minister Dr. Harshvardhan. The unique feature of these mobile testing labs is that their utility in diagnosing other infectious diseases beyond COVID. The first iLab was launched in New Delhi on 18th June 2020 and it has been built and implemented by Department of Biotechnology or DBT along with the Andhra Pradesh Meds Tech Zone or AMTZ. It has initiated the DBT AMTZ Command or COVID MedTech Manufacturing Development Consortia to address the shortage of critical healthcare technologies in India and move progressively towards a stage of self-sufficiency. It is Asia's first medical equipment manufacturing ecosystem uniquely dedicated for MedTech and supported by various ministries. Next is regarding India's election to the non-permanent seat of the UN Security Council for the term of 2021 to 2022. The UN Security Council is comprised of 15 members. 5 permanent members, which are China, France, Russian Federation, the United States and the United Kingdom, and 10 non-permanent members who are elected by the General Assembly. The non-permanent members are elected for 2-year terms. So, every year the General Assembly elects 5 non-permanent members out of the total 10. These 10 seats are distributed among the regions of the world. 5 seats for the African and Asian countries, 1 for Eastern European countries, 2 for Latin American and Caribbean countries, and 2 for Western European and other countries. Of the 5 seats for Africa and Asia, 3 are for Africa and 2 for Asia. The current non-permanent members of the Security Council are Belgium, Dominican Republic, Germany, Indonesia and South Africa, all of whose terms end this year, and Estonia, Niger, Saint Vincent and the Grenadines, Tunisia and Vietnam, whose terms end in 2021. India begins its term in the beginning of 2021 and will hold the position until the end of 2022. India has earlier been a non-permanent member of the Security Council in 1952-51, 67-68, 72-73, 77-78, 84-85, 91-92 and 2011-2012. Next is regarding the Kudumanal excavations, which has identified 250 cairn circles or burial sites at a village in Erode district of Tamil Nadu. Earlier excavations revealed that the site served as a trade cum industrial center from 5th century BC to 1st century BC. The Kudumanal excavations of 10 pots and bowls instead of the usual 3 or 4 pots placed outside the three chambered burial cist and inside the cairn circle has thrown light on burial rituals and the concept of afterlife in megalithic culture. The grave could be of a village head or the head of the community, as the size of the two boulders, each facing east and west, are bigger than the other boulders. Believing that the deceased person will get a new life after death, pots and bowls filled with grains were placed outside the chambers. Next is regarding Asian Development Outlook of 2020, published by Asian Development Bank. It forecasts a growth of 0.1% for the Asian region this year. The Indian economy is expected to contract by 4% during the current financial year before growing 5% in financial year 2021, as per the report. China, however, is expected to record a positive growth of 1.8% in 2020, sharply down from 6.1% in 2019. Next is regarding an employment cum rural public work campaign named Garib Kalyan Rozgar Abhiyan, launched by the Prime Minister. It aims to provide livelihood opportunities in areas or villages witnessing large number of returning migrant workers affected by the devastating COVID-19. The Abhiyan will be a convergent effort between different ministries or departments, namely Rural Development, Panchayati Raj, Road Transport and Highways, Mines, Drinking Water and Sanitation, Environment, Railways, Petroleum and Natural Gas, New and Renewable Energy, border roads, telecom and agriculture, to expedite implementation of 25 public infrastructure works and works related to augmentation of livelihood opportunities. The major objectives of the scheme are detailed in this slide. Those who want can pause the video and read. Next is regarding the International Yoga Day of 2020. Every year, June 21 is recognized as International Yoga Day. The theme set by the United Nations for the day this year is Yoga for Health, Yoga at Home, owing to the COVID-19 restrictions this year. Next is regarding Section 309 of Indian Penal Code, which gained much relevance since the suicide of actor Sushant Singh Rajput. Under Section 309, anyone who survives an attempted suicide can be booked under the Section 309 of IPC, which deals with attempts to commit suicide. The law brought in by the British in the 19th century reflected the thinking of that time, when killing or attempting to kill oneself was considered a crime against the state as well as against religion. But the Mental Health Care Act, or MHCA, of 2017, which came into force in July 2018, has significantly reduced the scope for the use of Section 309 of IPC and made the attempt to commit suicide punishable only as an exception. As per Section 115(1) of the Act, any person who attempts to commit suicide shall be presumed to have severe stress and shall not be tried and punished under IPC. So, we have discussed about the strategic importance of Galvan Valley in some previous slides. These slides give us some more details regarding the valley. The valley refers to the land that lies between the steep mountains on the sides of Galvan River. The river has its sources in Aksai Chin on China side of the line of actual control, which is the boundary demarcating the border between India and China. And it flows east to Ladakh, where it meets the Shyok River on India side of the line of actual control. The valley is strategically located between Ladakh in the west and Aksai Chin in the east, which is currently controlled by China as part of its Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region. At its western end are the Shyok River and the Darbuk Shyok Dauladbag Oldi or DSDBO road, about which we discussed in the previous slide. In eastern mouth lies not far from China's vital Xinjiang Tibet road, now called the G219 highway. You can see the picture of Galvan and Shyok rivers, the DSDBO road and the site of the clash in this map. Next is regarding the draft security law for Hong Kong unveiled by China. As we all know, Hong Kong is an autonomous region under the overall authority of China. Highlights of draft security law for Hong Kong include a special bureau in Hong Kong to investigate and prosecute crimes considered threatening to national security is planned for the area area. New police and the prosecution units will also be set up to investigate and enforce the law, and Hong Kong will establish a committee to safeguard the legislation headed by the city's leader Carrie Lam and supervised by the central government. Hong Kong, which was handed to China after British colonial rule ended in 1997, has been governed by a unique model aimed at guaranteeing freedoms not granted on the mainland. Critics fear these freedoms will now be curtailed by the law. Next is regarding yet another territorial dispute involving China, this time with Japan. It involves three small islands, Senkaku Islands in Japan, the Diaoyu Islands in the People's Republic of China, and Tiaoyutai Islands in the Republic of China or Taiwan. You can see the location of these islands highlighted in the picture. They are a group of uninhabited islands in the East China Sea. They are located east of mainland China, northeast of Taiwan, west of Okinawa Island, and north of the southwestern end of the Ryukyu Islands. In September 2012, the Japanese government purchased three of the disputed islands from their private owner, prompting large-scale protests in China. China now protests against Japan's move to rename these purchased islands in the name of challenges to sovereignty. Next is regarding the first virtual healthcare and hygiene expo 2020. It has been inaugurated by the Minister of States for Shipping and Chemicals and Fertilizers, Sri Mansukh Mandavia, and was organized by Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, or FICCI. This is the first time that an event will be organized on virtual platform and digitally accessed by buyers from across the globe. The first edition of this expo 2020 will comprise of 5-day comprehensive virtual exhibition on sectors like Ayush and wellness, medical devices, medical textiles and consumables, pharmaceuticals and sanitization. The virtual event will also feature webinars and discuss various issues and opportunities in focus sectors post COVID-19. Next is regarding the international project to develop a pathway to low carbon dioxide mobility for India. For this purpose, Niti Aayog, in collaboration with the International Transport Forum or ITF, will launch the Decarbonizing Transport in India project. The Decarbonizing Transport in India project will design a tailor-made transport emissions assessment framework for India. It will provide the government with a detailed understanding of current and future transport activity and the related carbon dioxide emissions as a basis for their decision making. The India project is carried out in the wider context of the International Transport Forum's Decarbonizing Transport Initiative. Information about a country of origin by the sellers to the government e-marketplace has been made mandatory by the government. Now, the government e-marketplace is a special purpose vehicle under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry for the purpose of procuring goods for various government departments. Government e-marketplace has taken this significant step to promote Make in India and Atmanirbhar Bharat. GEM has also enabled a provision for indication of the percentage of local content in products. With this new feature now, the country of origin as well as the local content percentage are visible in the marketplace for all items. The Make in India filter has now been enabled in the portal. Buyers can choose to buy only those products that meet the minimum 50% local content criteria. The World Bank has released new purchasing power parities or PPPs for reference year 2017 under International Comparison Program or ICP that adjust for differences in the cost of living across economies of the world. So what is purchasing power parity or PPP? It compares the relative values of currencies all over the world. As per the newest report, the purchasing power parities of Indian rupee per US dollar at a gross domestic product level is now 20.65 in 2017 from 15.55 in 2011, which means while a single dollar could have bought only worth of rupees 15.55 in 2011, it can buy worth of rupees 20.65 in 2017. This means that the value of dollar has increased while that of rupee has fallen. The exchange rate of US dollar to Indian rupee is now 65.12 from 46.67 during the same period, also showing a deterioration in value. the price level index or PLI, the ratio of a PPP to its corresponding market exchange rate, is used to compare the price levels of economies of India, is of which India's is 47.55 in 2017 from 42.99 in 2011. The International Comparison Program, or ICP, is the largest worldwide data collection initiative under the guidance of UN Statistical Commission, or UNSC, with the goal of producing purchasing power parities, which are vital for converting measures of economic activities to be comparable across the economies. Along with the PPPs, the ICP also produces price level indices, or PLIs, and other regionally comparable aggregates of GDP expenditure. The Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation is the nodal implementation agency, or NIA, for India, which has the responsibility for planning, coordinating, and implementing national ICP activities. Next is regarding Dhruva, which is a receiver chip developed by the students of IIT Bombay. The chip can be utilized in cell phones and gadgets to discover the locations and routes inside the nation. Dhruva will get signals from India's Navic group of navigation satellites, which, as you all know, is the Indian version of the GPS. The government has now approved private sector participation in space activities. Space sector can play a major catalytic role in the technological advancement and expansion of our industrial base. The proposed reforms will enhance the socio-economic use of space assets and activities, including through improved access to space assets, data and facilities. The newly created Indian National Space Promotion and Authorization Center, or INSPACE, which is formed as a regulator to the space sector, will provide a level playing field for private companies to use Indian space infrastructure. It will also handhold, promote and guide the private industries in space activities through encouraging policies and a friendly regulatory environment. Further effects of the policy is given in this slide. Next is regarding annual TB report of 2020. It was released by Union Minister of Health and Family Welfare. They also released a Joint Monitoring Mission, or JMM, report, a manual on direct benefit transfer to TB patient center, Nikshay system, which is a training module, and a quarterly newsletter, Nikshay Patrika. The key achievements listed in the report are detailedly given in the slide. Those who want can pause the video and read. The next is regarding indigenously developed torpedo decoy system, MARICH, which has been introduced by the Indian Navy. It can be fired from all frontline warships. Design and development of this anti-torpedo decoy system has been undertaken indigenously by DRDO Labs. The Bharat Electronics Limited, a defense PSU, would undertake the production of this decoy system. Next news item says that the Financial Action Task Force, or FATF, which is a global terror financing watchdog, has decided to keep Pakistan in the grey list for terror financing. Grey list is a kind of negative list where poor performing nations in case of measures against terror financing are listed. The decision has been taken as Pakistan has failed to check flow of money to terror groups like Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed. Now Pakistan will continue to remain in the grey list till FATF's next meeting to be held in October. Now it will be difficult for Pakistan to get financial aid from IMF, World Bank, ADB and the European Union, thus further enhancing problems for the nation, which is in a precarious financial situation already. If Pakistan fails to comply with the FATF directive by October, there is every possibility that the global body may put the country in the blacklist along with North Korea and Iran. Next is regarding the Indian National Space Promotion and Authorization Center, INSPACE. It is touted as the body that will ensure a level playing field for Indian industry in a fast-growing global space sector. It will function autonomously and parallel to ISRO. INSPACE is the second space organization created by the government in the last 2 years. Which is the other organization? It is New Space India Limited, or NSIL, a public sector company that would serve as a marketing arm of ISRO. Its main purpose is to market the technologies developed by ISRO and bring it more clients that need space-based services. World's first yoga university outside India has been launched in Los Angeles, USA. The yoga university has been named as the Vivekananda Yoga University, or VYU. The university was launched as a part of the commemoration for the 6th International Yoga Day. The university offers programs that combine scientific principles and modern research approaches to yoga. Next is regarding World Drug Report of 2020. It is being published by the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime, or UNODC. The 2020 World Drug Report provides a global overview of the supply and demand of opiates, cocaine, cannabis, amphetamine types, stimulants, and new psychoactive substances, or NPS, as well as their impact on health, taking into account the possible effects of the COVID-19 pandemic. It highlights that the adverse health consequences of a drug use are more widespread than previously thought. Next is regarding a campaign for planting trees initiated by Ministry of Culture. The ministry has decided to celebrate Sankalp Parva from 28th June to 12th July 2020, wherein ministry expects all its subordinate offices, academies, attached institutions, affiliated institutions to plant trees in its campus or at the surroundings wherever it is possible. Ministry of Culture recommends to plant 5 trees which have been identified by Prime Minister and which represents the herbal heritage of our country. These trees are Bargat, Avla, Peepal, Ashok and Bell. Next is regarding liquid cooling and heating garment developed by ISRO. It has now received a patent for this invention. Liquid cooling and heating garment, or LCHG, is a protective garment for human spaceflight. It is a close-fitting long garment that covers the torso as well as the limbs from neck to toe as a single-piece lightweight comfort innerwear. The flight suit has to be worn by the astronauts over the LCHG. The garment permits the long-term use without any impact on the wearer in terms of skin irritation or infection. Researchers in the UK are set to study the anthropos, a term they have coined to refer to the coronavirus-induced lockdown period and its impact on other species. We already know that the era in which we presently live has been termed as Anthropocene by scientists due to the massive impact humans induce on Earth and the ecosystem. The unprecedented curbs imposed on millions of people around the world, mainly due to the restrictions in travel, led to reports of unusual animal behavior. For instance, there were pumas sighted in Chile's Santiago, jackals in the parks of Tel Aviv in Israel, dolphins in the waters of Italy, and even a monkey fight on the streets of Thailand. The researchers believe studying this period will provide valuable insights into the relationships between human-wildlife interactions in the 21st century. Next is regarding Statistics Day, which is celebrated on 29th June every year to commemorate the birth anniversary of Professor P.C. Mahalanobis, in recognition of his invaluable contribution in establishing the national statistical system. The theme of Statistics Day 2020 was Sustainable Development Goal 3, or SDG 3, which is to ensure healthy lives and promote well-being for all at all ages, and a Sustainable Development Goal 5, which is to achieve gender equality and empower all women and girls. Next is regarding International Day of the Tropics, which is also observed on 29th June. The International Day of the Tropics was designated to raise awareness to the specific challenges faced by tropical areas, the far-reaching implications of the issues affecting the world's tropical zone, and the need at all levels to raise awareness and to underline the important role the countries in the tropics will play in achieving the Sustainable Development Goals. Next news item is that Operation Greens, which seeks to stabilize the supply of tomato, onion and potato, or top crops, and to ensure availability of the top crops throughout the country around the year without price volatility, which has been extended from top crops to other notified horticulture crops for providing subsidy for the transportation and storage from surplus production area to major consumption areas. The objective of intervention is to protect the growers of fruits and vegetables from making distress sale due to lockdown and reduce the post-harvest losses. The eligible crops under this scheme are listed in the slide. That's all for today, guys. Now, Race to IAS will start the 7th batch of the foundation course on 20th of July. The classes are designed in such a way that you can attend them at the comfort of your own rooms without leaving your house during this lockdown period. The link for the registration and the contact numbers for any queries are given in the slide. You can also follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter to get our regular updates. The links are provided in the description box below. We'll meet again next time. Until then, stay safe, guys. Goodbye.